For the past 20 years, LISC Phoenix has been helping Valley residents transform neglected neighborhoods into areas of pride by way of financial aid, technical assistance, and advocacy. Here to tell us more about the work of LISC Phoenix is its executive director, Teresa Brice. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Did I get that right? Is that pretty much what LISC does?
You did a great job. That's a great way to capsulize exactly what we've been doing for the last 20 years in the Phoenix area.
And I've heard it's a community development financial institution. What does that mean?
It's a long, complicated name, like our name, Local Initiative Support Corporation. But essentially what that means is we bring a variety of tools, financial and technical, to help neighbors build communities.
That makes you a mission-based lender, isn't it?
That's correct. In many ways, you can think of us as a bank or a foundation, because we do bring financial resources in the form of loans as well as grants. But I think the thing that distinguishes us is that we don't simply put money on the table and then walk away and hope for the best. We actually bring our skills and expertise, and we put them at the disposal of neighborhood residents and local nonprofits.
I've heard you described as the United Way of community development. Does that make sense?
That is true, because we have a variety of local partners, and so the funds that we bring, we distribute to the communities through that network of partners.
And we talked about creating a place of pride in certain neighborhoods and creating a there. What was the old thing about Oakland? There's no there.
That's right.
How do you get a there? What do you do? How does it work?
I think what we really have to do is capture a sense of community. And for every neighborhood, that's different. In historic neighborhoods, you've got a history, you've got a sense of pride, you've got a continuity there. In the newer neighborhoods, especially because Phoenix has grown so quickly, and as well as our other communities, it's harder to put a point on what exactly makes them unique. What we tend to do is to try to focus on those neighborhoods that are really at a tipping point, that perhaps have experienced disinvestment in the past, but because there's a rich culture and a sense of pride and identity, we want to capture that and help put those aspects to work in building better neighborhoods.
How do you get enough people to agree on what does capture that? I mean, that sounds like a lot of compromise, a lot of groupthink going on there.
Exactly. And that's essentially what democracy is. We ask the residents to come together. We are a national organization, but we don't parachute in from on high and say we have all the answers. What we say is we ask you to meet your neighbors, meet the business owners, meet the churches, the schools, all the stakeholders that make up your neighborhood, get together and decide on your own future. It's a long process. It's taken 18 months in our two target neighborhoods, and we're continuing that process in Mesa. That's just finalizing their quality of life plan.
I was going to ask, where are those two target neighborhoods?
In Phoenix, it's Central City South, which is immediately south of the downtown area, roughly bounded by Jackson down to the freeway I-17, Central Avenue, 19th Avenue, and then the Golden Gate neighborhood, which runs along McDowell between 35th Avenue and about 45th Avenue. In Mesa, it's the Washington Escobedo neighborhood, which is just north of the downtown area, bounded by University, Mesa Drive, and Center Street.
Okay. I know as well that there's a focus on transit-oriented development, too. Now, these two neighborhoods don't sound like they're all that close to light rail, or perhaps the Mesa area will be close to light rail.
Correct.
But talk about the transit projects.
Actually, all the neighborhoods are either within a currently planned transit extension or are in the planning process for that. Central City South is currently undergoing an alternatives study to help them decide, and the City of Phoenix to decide, whether or not to extend transit down Central Avenue, South Central Avenue. Mm. And that runs along the eastern boundary of Central City South. In the Golden Gate neighborhood, the west extension is going to be running along very close to McDowell, which is their southern boundary. And of course, in Mesa, Washington neighborhood is within half a mile of the new extension that just broke ground last week.
Now, how do you get people to figure out what they want there, what they need there, and get commercial interests as well? Because one of the things about light rail, one of the promises of light rail, is that it will develop commercial industries, businesses, restaurants, the whole nine yards along the route. How does that work? What's the dynamic there?
Economic development is really critical, and that's what these neighborhoods, by and large, are lacking. So they are really interested in joining arms with the businesses and the potential businesses that could benefit from having light rail. The whole point of light rail is that it sparks redevelopment, and that's exactly what we need. So what part of our job is to help neighbors understand that being a transit-oriented community means that You have to look at increased density. You have to look at increased community facilities, whether or not you're going to locate grocery stores, child care facilities, community health clinics. All of these things add to the sustainability of a neighborhood. And it requires conversation, it requires compromise, and give and take, because many of these older neighborhoods were not built for higher density. They're not used to having anything more than a couple of stories. And that's really the transformation that's going to occur along the light rail.
How do you get city leaders? How do you get elected officials on board with certain ideas when they may be saying, that's a great idea, can't afford it right now?
I think the most important aspect of focusing on transit-oriented development along the corridor that we currently have is that we're leveraging an existing public infrastructure investment. And that's what's really critical. Phoenix and our other cities in the Valley have the choice. As we continue to grow, are we going to continue to spend money further and further away from these huge public infrastructure investments? Or do we want to leverage those infrastructure investments with the private capital that LISC brings to the table?
It's something called divine legacy I was looking at as well. What is that all about?
Well, I don't know if you recall, we were here about a year ago on June 1st when we launched the TOD fund, LISC bringing $10 million, Raza Development, our partners bringing $10 million. And as a result of those investments, certain projects have already begun to move forward. Divine Legacy is one of those that took advantage of some pre-development loans. They completed construction, they opened their doors last year, and now they're almost completely rented up.
Interesting. I know that when we talked last time, the idea of building and renovating a long light rail was key. Give me an example. Let's say that I'm in a neighborhood along Washington Street, and light rail is right there, but the whole area is either warehouses, empty warehouses, or parking lots. Nothing going on there.
Right.
How do I come to you? Do you come to us? How do we work to make that a viable, how do we get a there, in other words?
There's several avenues. In the case of Central City South, they have worked, as I said, for 18 months with a quality of life plan, and they've set out a very broad agenda that includes things like health, transportation, housing, economic development, and there's lots of ideas with lots of projects. So they can bring a project to us and say, help us find a developer, help us find somebody that can understand how to put this project together, work with the neighborhood, get our input, and make this successful. If we're talking to the cities own multiple acres of land along the light rail. The city of Tempe may decide that there's a particular area that they would like to see developed, and they can come to us and say, can you help us identify a developer? Or a developer may already own a piece of land, and they want us to help bring additional public funds, low-income housing tax credits, or bond financing to help make their project successful. Our job is to be able to take all those pieces and help put them together into a whole that will make the community proud.
Well, it sounds like encouraging work, and it sounds like you've got some work completed already and more in the pipeline. Congratulations.
Exactly.
Good to speak with you again.
Thank you so much.